Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Krista. Good afternoon. This is my favorite part about being an MC. Hello, everyone, and good afternoon. My name is Andrew McMahon. I'm the Senior Advisor for Technology for the General Services Administration. I'm also the Regional Administrator for GSA's region out here on the West Coast. Welcome to 50 United Nations Plaza, home to GSA's regional headquarters and the physical home to SUPERPUBLIC. This week, BridgeSF is bringing together policymakers and leading innovators from across the Bay Area and around the world for a four-day event focused on critical issues facing our cities, states, government agencies, and most importantly, our constituents. Some of you will hear me present again tomorrow, so I'm going to keep my remarks short here. This event is important for a number of reasons, not at least of which is because BridgeSF dovetails very well with our new endeavor, SUPERPUBLIC, the nation's first collaborative workspace to host city, state, and federal policymakers under one roof, among also our academic, nonprofit, and private sector partners. Additionally, I truly believe that we're at an inflection point in governance and public service delivery. Elected officials and policymakers are becoming more and more aware of the power and ubiquity of technology in their work and its ability to provide quality service to their constituents. Platforms like BridgeSF and SUPERPUBLIC tie together stakeholders at all stages of digital government transformation. These forums are a critical part of challenging paradigms and moving us in the direction we need to head. I'm very excited to see the actionable insights from this afternoon throughout the week. Now, without further ado, please welcome our first speaker kicking off this afternoon's series of talks and panels, City Innovate Foundation Executive Director Cameron Sadiq.
I've actually been, whoa, that's loud. I think I'm going to sit back a little. I've actually been given this thing today, so I have to read it out just to thank everybody. And I think, you know, I'm getting used to just thanking people and not really adding anything useful. So I think during the day, you'll hear all the useful stuff, and I'll do the thanking and probably annoy somebody that I've left out. So again, yeah, good afternoon. Cameron Sadiq. I think most of you know me as a co-founder of City Innovate Foundation and current ED until time will tell. I get kicked out or get replaced by somebody who can do the job a bit better than me. And we're actually, you know, welcome to SUPERPUBLIC. And, you know, we're really honored for all of you folks here to see the opening ceremony for BridgeSF. And, you know, to thank our partners, the Mayor's Office of San Francisco, UC Berkeley, and, of course, the one that I always forget, City Innovate Foundation. And special thanks goes to our partner, Microsoft. Not only were they capstone partners last year, but again this year, and also, you know, sort of been behind the SUPERPUBLIC sort of piece at the very beginning, and, you know, big thank you out there, especially for these civic innovation labs in supporting us. The idea behind the summit was really to bring some of the colliders that Gert was actually running through with you, some of these projects that we're working with on a continuous basis with people like Jay Nath, Kieran Jane at the City of Oakland, and obviously Jay at City of San Francisco. How do we sort of make sure that we get international cities, our civic innovators, you know, all together in one space to sort of look at the learnings and look at the things that we want to do out there in the future, and also engage some of our international cities, who I'll make sure I remember to thank again towards the end. Now, I know Adam has asked me to say this, so I'm going to read this out verbatim so I don't get in trouble. He's written, already we've done a lot. This weekend featured a hackathon led by Susan's team at Berkeley. So I don't know if any of you know Susan Shaheen. She can't be here today, but she definitely led the hackathon on a Labor Day weekend. So I feel sorry for her because the rest of us were on holiday. We've completed our demo day, so thanks, Adam. I heard it went off really well. And there were 12 civic-minded startups with any winners?
There was one winner. Actually, to be honest, they were all
winners. Okay, great. Where are they going? Singapore? Great. That's really cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. So there you go. Somebody, the CEO of Singapore is here, so I'm sure he'll entertain him. And then tomorrow on campus, I mean, one of the things that we've tried to do different, last year we had over 1,000 people at a hotel downtown in San Francisco. This year we said, let's go on campus, let's go to UC Berkeley, and I'll sort of talk about what we'd like to do there in year three very quickly, but tomorrow, I think it's going to be a trek, so anyone who complains, please go to Adam. That was his idea. And on Thursday, I mean, we're lucky. We've got, you know, I mean, there's some great people here who've been invited, our speakers and moderators, all that are here. I mean, on Thursday, you're going to see 12 panels, and we'll cover resiliency, econ development, and urban mobility, three areas that we felt were critical in discussions in today's cities. So you'll see that on Thursday. And then I think on Friday, Adam, I don't know who's going to be around, but you have open houses and tours. Anything interesting? And one of the things that I'm suggesting for next year is that we've been talking to UC Berkeley is how do we turn the campus into actually a living lab for next year's summit and really do an innovation week and look at AV vehicles, et cetera. There's a lot of things that they can do that we can't do here in the city, and that's something that we're really pushing hard with their team out there. And, you know, I obviously would love our visiting delegates from Singapore, Dubai, Kobe, Copenhagen, Stavanger, Zurich, and more that, you know, we'd love to speak to you about the creation of a SUPERPUBLIC. We're getting everybody from Chattanooga, Miami-Dade, DC, all who want to create SUPERPUBLIC, so we're excited, so we want to keep that conversation actually going. And again, thank you to the folks at Bridge SF for putting this thing together. And I'm just gonna, you know, thank our guests of honor for the opening ceremony, Mayor Ed Lee of San Francisco, and Mayor Libby Schaff of the City of Oakland. They'll be coming in at 4:30. Making an entrance, table one and table two. Mayor Christine Sagan-Helga from Stavanger, thank you for coming out here all the way from Norway. Her Excellency, Dr. Aisha Bin Bishr, Director General of Smart Dubai Office, thank you. And of course, Mr. Cho Ho Chan, Government Chief Information Officer for Singapore, for coming out here. And everybody else, thank you. And I'll give it back to our wonderful Master of Ceremonies. Thank you.
Thank you, Cameron. Our next speaker is Peter Hirschberg, chairman and co-founder of the City Innovate Foundation. Peter is a longtime thought leader in this space. Please welcome Peter Hirschberg.
Well, thank you and welcome. And as Mayor Lee will tell you later today, we see ourselves here as the innovation capital of the world. But what we realize is cities are really the nexus of innovation in the world. And this is about making those connections between cities to drive innovation. This is the fastest time of technology development in history. And if we're going to kind of build a great sustainable future, it's going to be because the great ideas and the connection points between cities evolve. And what's amazing here is we're anchored by Singapore and Dubai that focus on the fastest growing parts of the earth with two distinct visions of how you build smart cities. We have Northern Europe, which is its visions. And here in San Francisco, the one thing we know is we need to be a connection point and do kind of all of this stuff together. San Francisco led an effort about 8 years ago when it opened up its data. And what we realized then was it was an enormous invitation. All sorts of people flowed in and started collaborating and working together. The original vision of a smart city was kind of a top-down thing. It was you call a vendor in and they'd make you a smart city. And what everybody has realized is all of the talent in cities, all of the startups together in some heterodox way is how we're going to go build a better world. We have more problems than ever before and more people working on it, and all of this will get resolved in cities. And this organization, SUPERPUBLIC and City Innovate, has been built as a connection point, an experiment point, and it works best because it's not a city lab, it's a cities lab for all of us to work together. So thank you for coming to this Bridge Week, and we hope you'll collaborate with us moving forward on the many exciting problems we have to solve, because we're only going to get to tomorrow by cities collaborating together in what is probably the most important political and economic unit on Earth. Thank you. And now, back to our Master of Ceremonies.
Thank you, Peter. Our next guest is a fellow co-founder and the Deputy Executive Director of 18F, which is the federal government's digital consultancy. And also a neighbor to SUPERPUBLIC in one of their offices. So without further ado, Hillary Hartley.
Thank you, Andrew and Cameron, the whole team. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, some of our farther travelers, for making it all the way to San Francisco for this incredible event. We're extremely excited to be a part of it. Something that you might hear over the next couple of days are three numbers and letters. 1-8-F, 18-F. Andrew's going to talk a little bit about it tomorrow, but essentially 18F is kind of the home, if I could be so bold, the home of innovation inside the General Services Administration for sure, and has really been the tip of the spear for a lot of the innovation that's happening on the federal level. About 4 years ago, almost exactly, because if I'm correct, I think TechCrunch Disrupt is happening this coming weekend. I'm going to read it just so I don't mess it up. But Todd Park and Steve Van Roekel. Todd Park at the time was the Chief Technology Officer of the United States, and Steve Van Roekel was the Chief Information Officer of the United States. They stood on stage here in San Francisco and announced the creation of the Presidential Innovation Fellowship. Todd said, you know, that they wanted the baddest innovators and people from the technology industry to come to DC and help kind of disrupt government. You know, think of government as an industry and think of what you have done in your position to disrupt what you're working on and bring that to government. And he stood on stage and said, do what you would do in the private sector and we will blow up the barriers in the way. And so that's really been kind of the, you know, the thing that pushed innovation and the sort of opened the floodgates on the federal level, and that was really just 4 years ago. Things had been happening obviously prior to that, but we have seen really just an openness start to happen. That's been the game changer. People like Andrew, as the senior policy advisor to the administrator, championing and being in the administrator's ear and saying, "Listen, these folks, you know, sure they come in jeans and sneakers, but we need them. We need them at the table. We need them at the table so that, you know, decisions are being made smartly, so that we can change the way we're thinking about approaching problems." And that's really what we have been doing for the last couple of years. So you'll hear more about 18F tomorrow, but it is essentially a civic consultancy inside the federal government. We are federal employees here at the GSA, the General Services Administration, a consultancy, you know, of federal employees for federal employees. So we work with other federal agencies to help them solve problems, approach things differently, build software, maybe, you know, acquire software. We're running a lot of different experiments in the acquisition space to really kind of change the mental model of how we approach acquisitions in the technology sector. So there's a lot going on. If you have any questions, you can ask me, you can ask Andrew. As Cameron said, we are hallmates to SuperPublic, so on your way out, if anybody is still there, feel free to wave and say hello. I would also invite you all, on Thursdays we do potluck lunch. So it is meant to be a time to come and meet the team and talk about projects, talk about ideas. So we take it very, you know, seriously. If you would like to come have lunch with us, please do that on a Thursday. We eat at noon. Again, my name's Hillary. Thank you all for being here, and we're glad we can be a part of this.
Thank you, Hillary. The potluck is also a recruiting tool, so don't send any of your staff. I wouldn't recommend it. Next up is Jay Nath, Chief Innovation Officer for the City of San Francisco's Mayor Ed Lee. He's been a great partner and co-founder of the SuperPublic initiative as well. Jay, thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. I just want to share a story with you of something that happened 2 years ago in San Francisco government that I think really is a testament to the collaboration and the platform we want to create. Our airport formed a partnership with a company from Austria, as well as a collaboration with a local nonprofit that supports the blind community. And their goal was to help really make it easier for the blind community to navigate through our airport. And so in 16 weeks, as part of our startup and residence program, they all worked collaboratively together to overcome procurement barriers, to share data, to really work together on fixing this problem. And it was amazing for me to see this happen in real time, in 16 weeks. Since then, we've brokered 36 collaborations like that. And we think that's what SuperPublic is all about, that it's a platform for creating new solutions, for helping cities, for helping governments, you know, all across the country. When we talk about the challenges that we're facing in our city, we recognize those challenges are not going to be solved just by City Hall. that we need to work closely with the private sector, with the nonprofit sector, with everybody, really the best and brightest working together. And so at SuperPublic, we're thinking deeply about what does that collaboration look like? How do we actually work together to create those outcomes? And so we want to invite all of you to join us in thinking about what does that model look like? How do we create impact? And how do we do this at scale? Many of you are from outside of the US, and there's so much we can learn from the work that you're doing, and hopefully we can share the work that we're doing as well. I want to end by just thanking some of the core partners here. I want to thank UC Berkeley for their leadership and just recognizing that it's really difficult as a large institution to be nimble and to move quickly, and that's what we've asked them to do and to break out of their mold. I also want to thank GSA, Andrew, and Hillary. They've been an inspiration for our city in so many ways, and I think across the country as well, not just 18F, but the amazing work that they're doing on so many different levels. And of course, Andrew, for taking coffee with me to pitch the idea of, hey, let's do this within 50 UN Plaza, and him recognizing the value of SuperPublic immediately and really believing in it. So thank you, Andrew and Hillary, for all of your support. I want to thank Cameron and his team, just so much dedication. They are working so hard to make this happen, really going into the unknown here. We haven't done this before, so we're really trying to figure this out, and it's a testament to their dedication. And last, I want to thank my team, Krista, who was inspired by a conversation in London. SuperPublic in Paris was a great inspiration for us, so thank you, Krista, for importing that idea from Paris back to the US and making that journey with all of us. And with that, I'll hand it off to our MC, Andrew. Thank you.
Thank you, Jay. I'm sorry I have to make you go through the metal detectors still every time you come into the building and everyone else. And now we're going to move on to the first of our two panels this afternoon. I'd like to invite the moderator, Marcy Harris, founder and CEO of Popbox, as well as panelist Stacey Donahue of the Midyard Network, Stephanie Santoso of the Moore Foundation, and Kieran Jane, Chief Resiliency Officer of the City of Oakland, to the front of the room.
Excellent. Apparently, we have some logistical things going on here. So thank you so much. And I just want to echo what Jay was saying about the inspiration that is 18F and all the work that has happened to build that. And I would say also for people like Jay, who have been such pioneers in this space. Stacey Donahue and I had a chance to speak about a few minutes ago as we were getting started, and we were talking about the good old days at the beginning of civic tech, a little 8 years ago. And so we were talking about what an amazing experience it is to be here in a room like this with people from all over the world thinking about all that has happened in just so few years. So I have the honor of moderating a panel on foundations in this space, and we decided we would really mix it up this time and do this panel without any foundations on the panel of foundations. So in order to do that, I have some wonderful partners here, and let me just go down and introduce Kieran Jane, who is the Chief Resiliency Officer at the City of Oakland, and Marcia Kadanoff, who's Chief Strategy Officer at City Innovate, and Stacey Donahue, who is an investment partner at Omidyar Networks, which you might think is a foundation, but I'm here to tell you it is not. Stacey, what is Omidyar Network, and how is it not a foundation?
Thanks, Marcy. So Omidyar Network is a philanthropic investment firm that was started by Pierre Omidyar, the founder of eBay, and his wife, Pam, about 10 years ago. And we do both for-profit social impact investing and grant making, and a variety of things that sort of fall in between those two poles, in five different initiative areas, one of which is called governance and citizen engagement, but we call it civic tech for short. And so when I heard I was going to be on this panel, the first thing I said to Marcy was, please don't call us a foundation, because we really are trying to break the mold of one specific type of funding and really think about what is the problem that we're trying to solve, and then what's the most appropriate financial tool to solve that problem. So we invest in companies, for-profit companies, that are using technology to enhance the relationship between citizens and government in order to give citizens more voice, and also to make government service delivery more accessible, fair, effective, and efficient. And we also support a lot of what we call ecosystem building activities to support those companies and those nonprofits in order to build a more thriving ecosystem around civic tech, because, as Marcy just pointed out, civic tech as a thing has really only been around for about 8 years, more or less, 10 if you're getting really expansive. And so it's really nascent as a field, and it is really inspiring to look around the room today and see both familiar faces and a lot of new faces that are building this sector in this field in the US, in Europe, in Asia, in Latin America, and elsewhere, because it really is a global phenomenon, which is something we'll probably get back to. But.
Well, and actually, Marcia, I should have said, I guess City Innovate Foundation is actually a foundation. So you will be our key member of the foundation community on our panel of foundations.
Well, that's interesting, because while we're a foundation, we're not a grant-making institution. So let me explain. Our mission closely mirrors your mission in the government space. We're here to make more government more effective, more efficient, more just, and more inclusive. And in fact, one of the programs we look forward to standing up in the next coming year is something we call the Metro Innovation Fellows, which is something we're modeling on President Obama's Innovation Fellows. The notion is that there are many cities and towns in the United States that are not as blessed as San Francisco with the kind of ecosystem that we have, and even the staffing we have in Jay and Krista, where we have a mayor's office of innovation. And so how do we take what we've learned here in San Francisco about civics tech and civic innovation and spread that more widely throughout the United States and, in fact, throughout the globe? And so that's really our mission here at the foundation. We depend on the kindness of corporate grants, and also we're looking at traditional philanthropic sources of funding, and finally at government funding. So those are our three sources of funding, and we look forward to working with you in the coming years to build more innovation capacity in cities and metros.
And Kieran actually represents the receiving end of foundation funding as the Chief Resiliency Officer of the City of Oakland, as a part of the 100 Resilient Cities program with the funded by the Rockefeller Foundation. So I would love for you to tell us a bit more about that initiative and also how it's going.
Yeah, absolutely. So as Marcy mentioned, I am one of 100 chief resilience officers throughout the world that is funded by 100 Resilient Cities, which is a project of the Rockefeller Foundation, to think about how we can seed innovation more closely in government to solve some of the complex challenges of our day, including sea level rise, risk of drought and floods, and how technology plays a role in actually thinking about not only how to adapt, but also how to move us faster as a government. So it's 100 experiments happening throughout the world right now. We are one of them in Oakland, and it's been a really interesting way to network with other cities around these issues, not just on the physical scale, but also on the social resilience side. And so through the Rockefeller Foundation, we actually have what are called platform partnerships, where we're able to partner with private enterprise on helping us solve some of these problems. So a couple of quick examples, AutoCase, which I think was co-developed by Autodesk and Impact Infrastructure, is a technology tool for us to assess triple bottom line value of green infrastructure projects. It's a really neat way to help us make the business case for why we need to be thinking about sustainability and resilience in our city policymaking. So there's a lot more examples I can share, but that's really a quick rundown of what we're doing through the 100RC platform.
Well, and I could pretty much spend hours asking questions about all of these things, but I have a quick follow-up question for you, Kieran. So as one of 100 resiliency officers around the world,
Are you working together with the other resiliency officers? Is there kind of a sharing of best practices that's emerging?
Yeah, absolutely. So there is a network that Rockefeller has put together. We do meet once a year in some locale. Last year it was Mexico City. This year it most likely will be New York. And there is a lot of idea sharing and best practices going on, but there's also an awareness that every city is also situated, right, with its own challenges. And so it's also been a way for us to kind of say, okay, Boston, how are you tackling equity and resilience, and what's Oakland doing? And just having this this dialogue has been really helpful. And then I want to underscore the support of the Rockefeller Foundation, because they're actually financing these positions inside government, right? So it's 100 chief resilience officers who are given anywhere from a 2 to 3 year grant to help make the case, to sell it internally as well as externally, and to then institutionalize it, which is what we're starting to see now. For example, San Francisco also has a CRO, and Berkeley, as well as Los Angeles.
Oh, the Bay Area is very covered. Stacey, when we talked, you mentioned that Omidyar Network is certainly global, and also that many times some of the partners that you're funding or granting to in whichever funding mechanism are going even before the government is ready, and in some cases kind of leading the way. Can you say a bit about the projects that you work with worldwide and what you're seeing there?
Sure. So we say that the flavor of civic tech differs by geography quite a bit. And in some ways, the UK was clearly the kind of pioneer in this space with government digital services. And then the US, obviously, with 18F, has also been one of the pioneers in this space. We've seen, though, that in some environments, the nonprofits or even for-profit companies are starting to create solutions in advance of government adoption, and that also there are flavors of civic tech that are more kind of citizen-to-citizen oriented in other geographies, whereas the ones in the U.S. that we see now tend to be more either citizen-to-government oriented or what people commonly call GovTech. So I'd say, Marcy, to answer your question, that the biggest difference we see is in some of the Western countries that GovTech, as a subset of the broader civic tech umbrella, is more developed, particularly in a kind of for-profit investment atmosphere. And you see mainstream venture investors starting to invest in GovTech. Whereas in India and Africa, which are two regions where we work quite a bit, there's less GovTech per se and more citizen-oriented civic tech.
And Marcia, you mentioned that you're starting to see a different phenomenon, which is governments working with nonprofits almost as intermediaries for some of these projects.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for asking me that question. We have been chatting with some high-level officials in the Obama administration who are very concerned that the momentum that they have continue across the great divide between the next administration, which may or may not be a great divide. We're not allowed to be partisan, of course. And so among their concerns is they would really like to see innovation institutionalized inside cities, states, and local governments, and they are unsure how to do that. Do we establish 100, to pick up on what Kieran said, do we establish 100 18Fs and have them flourish? Do we take the methodologies and the tools that 18F has created and their sister agencies, the digital service and the technology transformation service, which is the official home of 18F? And then they're also very interested in the Smart City Challenge, which 66 cities qualified for the Smart City Challenge. 78 cities ended up applying. So there's some cities that didn't qualify.
Aspirational.
aspirational, exactly. And how do we take money at the federal level and inject it more smoothly into local and city and state government? And so those are the kinds of conversations we've been having. And what we're hearing is, as a nonprofit that is not a grant-making organization, that we can be a trusted intermediary in a couple of different ways. We can engage the cities in the dialogue, bring them to the table, and then in a somewhat prescriptive fashion that sometimes is more difficult for agencies to do at the federal level, we could prescribe exactly what it is that they need to do to get federal funds, and then we can also establish common metrics so that we can have 1,000 experiments bloom and measure and run them in a way that we can pool that knowledge. So that's what we're looking at. It is a new model. As Jay mentioned when he spoke, as Andrew mentioned when he spoke, we're walking the talk every day. It's all new, and it's exciting.
Well, so that tees up a question that I have, given the upcoming election, that we will have new lawmakers and executives at all levels of government next year, you know, from the smallest towns and city councils to state governments and federal government. That's a big question, what you would tell them all starting out, but are there some things that you've observed, Kieran, from your experience working in the city of Oakland, and Marcia from working at all levels, and Stacy, of course, seeing so many projects all over the world, is there advice that you would give to elected officials just coming in? What if they've never even heard of the term civic tech or related in terms, and how would you advise them to think about this and innovation?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's all about context, right? Like, they might not have heard of the term civic tech, but everybody understands that we need to modernize government. And it's interesting that we say that civic tech is 8 years old. You know, it happened during the height of the Great Recession, right? Crisis loves opportunity. And what are some ways that we're rethinking government and the way we do business? And I think that's at the heart of all the work that we're doing around this room. And I think that will definitely appeal to any elected official that you might talk to.
So I would add that the globe is reurbanizing at a very rapid rate. Cities have proven to be, as my colleague Peter Hirschberg said, have proven to be the right unit of innovation. So you see GE moving out of Fairfax, Connecticut to downtown Boston, and you see Jeff Immelt, I hope I'm pronouncing his name correctly, saying things like, I want my people to leave their offices in Boston and go out into the seaport and be absolutely terrified of the sea of innovation that they're looking at, as opposed to thinking about the internal politics. And so my point is this, that cities are having major problems from this rush to a new populace coming into our cities, and this reurbanization is leading to a lot of gentrification, a lot of displacement. We cannot hope to solve these new problems with old techniques, old methodologies, and without embracing innovation and new technologies. And so that's what I would tell city officials, is the status quo just won't cut it.
Yeah, I would add to that, for new people coming in, that networking and finding the tribes of people who are working in this space is critically important. You know, Code for America, which many of you are probably familiar with, was one of the first organizations to start to seed innovation at city government levels by having fellows come into cities for a year and help cities engage better with their technology and their data to be more citizen-centric. And now they've certainly evolved over time, but that's one example of a network of cities with people who have started small with something like a fellowship, tried out some new things, and then seen how they work. And now Code for America, for example, is shifting its strategy to go deep in a few focus areas like health and human services, economic development, and criminal justice, and are creating technologies that can be replicated across government. So the second piece of advice I would give is, you know, don't reinvent the wheel and feel like you have to start from scratch. Part of that networking is also finding out about what solutions are out there that can be shared and replicated across cities or across counties or across states. There really are a lot of resources and projects out there for people who've either been in government for a long time but are new to this type of work, or people who are displacing incumbents and coming in for the first time. And so those are the two things that I would suggest, is networking and not reinventing, sharing what's out there and using it again.
Well, and also I think, as you're mentioning, not reinventing the wheel, there's a certain amount of displacing political risk that comes from networking and kind of working with things that are ongoing, or even potentially with a larger program that's in 100 cities rather than just just trying it in a one-off and having a support network or a tribe, as you described. So Kieran, actually, I would ask you from a kind of how success is being defined for the Resilient Cities Initiative, but also even perhaps for you as the CRO of Oakland, how does that feel, and how even does the perhaps innovative desire to try new things and fail fast meet with the political risk intolerance and difficulty there?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we're writing our strategy as I speak, so I invite all of you to actually help and give me some ideas. But some of the things that we're bouncing around is around this idea of setting goals and actions within our strategy and actually putting KPIs with them. And one example is we invited Frog Design.
What is a KPI?
A key performance indicator. thank you. Basically to measure success, right? So we set a goal, do we hit it? And in one area we're trying to do is obviously right now in the Bay Area, we know that displacement is like one of the key issues facing our mayors. And so as part of the resilience strategy, we brought in Frog Design to help look at our rent adjustment program.
And what is Frog Design?
So Frog is a design thinking firm like an IDEO or, you know, bringing in kind of user-centered processes to, and also bringing together, more importantly, stakeholders who are touched by this process. So we ran a workshop with property owners and tenants and rent adjustment program staff, folks who've been involved in some really contentious conversations, and I put that lightly, actually, the last several months, and brought them into a room with the well-intentioned designed conversation around, if you could co-create a service that could better serve your needs, what would that look like? And so we are now in the process of, you know, forming a scope of work, putting out an RFP in a couple of weeks around this to get people to think about, you know, a digital service that we're looking to create in 4 months. But we're also putting a performance metric, trying to say, okay, well, what would that look like when the program is up and running? And today it's all paper-based for, it's very, very low-hanging fruit when it comes to innovating in this one particular area. But once, you know, if we're making it more user-centered, what does increased adoption and usage look like? And what is satisfaction with that service look like? So those are questions we're starting to seed inside City Hall right now around this particular program. But I see it happening all throughout our local government, right? I mean, there are pods of innovation happening in every department within the city. And I think it's important to recognize that we talk about civic tech or innovation maybe as one office or one thing, but it is something that touches all of these different areas.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think that's very similar to how we're starting to hear now. All companies are tech companies, and certainly all city departments should be tasked to innovate. I also hear you saying that your definitions of success are not predetermined for you by Rockefeller. You are engaging with the community to decide what those metrics of success will be and then incorporating it.
Yeah, and I guess one more thing we should add as part of this strategy is that we actually are co-creating what community engagement looks like, both analog and digitally. I know that's a really big question and we're not going to answer it in one full swoop, but we've actually invited community organizations in with city staffers who are doing a lot of community engagement work, because I think the feedback we're getting from community organizations is that you ask for our input or our feedback, but then what happens, right? So creating that feedback loop and making it coincide or feed in to user needs is really kind of how we're trying to push the conversation around equitable community engagement. Again, everything is an experiment, so we'll see how it goes, but that's the direction we're heading.
Well, and Marcia, I think you might know a thing or two about community involvement, user testing, or have some ideas on that?
So one of the initiatives we're standing up that feeds, I think, directly into what you're doing is...
Hello.
Okay. One of the initiatives that we're working on is something called a CUT Lab, which the Mayor's Office of Civic Innovation in San Francisco came up with a great name for it called A Public Voice. And the idea is, how do you get citizens with and residents with a low level of digital literacy to look at your digital services, to test certain tasks, like logging in, like applying for food stamps, what have you, applying to pay for subsidized housing, and use those results to, in a very agile manner, to change the digital service on the fly. User testing is like the secret sauce that's inside many of the very popular software service products that we all know and rely upon. whether it's Gmail. I mean, I could list 100 of them. I should list Microsoft one since they're a core sponsor. Citizen user testing is a very it's a very powerful thing. And what you can do is you can see the results. You talked about closing the feedback loop. You can see the results in the proven in the product, which is just much easier for someone to navigate. The other effect that's sort of interesting is once you have citizens and residents go through this process, they feel more empowered that they mastered a new technology product, and therefore they can go on and master another new technology product. And while we can't prove it yet, one of the things that we're excited about is we think that this leads to greater employment opportunities, greater economic development opportunities for the cities that sponsor these cut labs. So we're quite excited about this.
Well, and as someone with a company that thinks a lot about user testing, it's hard to set up user testing and to have it going on in an ongoing way. It's not something that is inherent, you know, a skill that people who are working in the city necessarily can just throw together on the fly. So having these resources is certainly extremely valuable. Stacey, I know that you fund so many organizations that are doing their own testing and measuring success in different ways. So I'll ask a bigger question, actually. But in a meta sense, with so many projects around the world, it's almost such a big question, I apologize in advance, but what is success for Omidyar Network? How do you gauge success with all of the projects and companies that you're working with?
Yeah, it is a meta question. And we struggle with it. And we've evolved our thinking over the years we've been engaged in this, and we'll continue to evolve it. We try to think about direct impact and indirect impact. Because our primary objective is impact. Any kind of financial returns are secondary, but we're in this for human impact. And so, you know, we look at metrics that the companies or nonprofits themselves are tracking around impact, typically around, you know, lives touched in some sort of way, or users of a technology, or beneficiaries or clients of a government service. And we want to see those numbers growing. We also look at indirect impact of citizens being able to access government services in more fair, effective, and efficient ways, and what the kind of follow-on effects of those impacts are. And then finally, we think about kind of ecosystem building impact. And Hillary had mentioned earlier the creation of the Presidential Innovation Fellowship Program. And that's a great example of ecosystem impact that, you know, Code for America started a fellowship program, and Todd Park, when he created the PIF program, said it was based directly off of CFA. And so seeing those types of models spread is also very impactful. Or the way Jay's had the innovation office here in San Francisco, New Urban Mechanics in Boston, all of these types of programs that try to shift risk away in order to get people to the freedom, degrees of freedom to innovate and experiment, we also think of as impact. And I just wanted to highlight something you said a minute ago about risk-taking. I think one of the fundamental challenges when you bring technology into the public sector is that the incentives are incredibly different around risk-taking. You know, in technology startups, risk-taking is at the core of what you do, and the penalty for failure is relatively small. You can fail fast, hopefully, and start again. And the thing that keeps you going is just, can you show enough progress to raise more funding until you kind of get it right? Whereas in government, the penalty for failure can be very high. It can be your career. And so one of the things that we think is most innovative are, or that we like to see experimenting with, is different ways to encourage the risk-taking or take the penalty of failure out of government, so that technologists and policymakers and career government people will be in an environment that's more conducive to risk taking.
Well, and it's so funny thinking about the impact measurement. It's also very difficult in this space, I think, because you know, there can be a sense of we've been working for so long we haven't fixed it yet. I remember actually sitting down with someone who said, well, how will you know when you've, how long do you think it's going to take to fix Congress? And I thought, well, you know, we make improvements around the edges here. But also to your point about risk, sometimes it can feel like such a zero-sum game when you throw politics into it. And for every, you know, failing fast is not just something that happens to a project that costs money or time and energy, but it can also be someone else's raison d'etre. So I wanted to ask you about trends and what you're seeing and what you think is coming next in this space. So now we know how you're looking at success, but as you work on your own projects, what do you think is emerging, or even in your own thinking, what do you think is something that you'd like to focus on in the coming year? And again, I think probably you're in the middle of your strategy plan, so that may be very much top of mind now for you.
You know, I think from a personnel and kind of process perspective, I see people throughout our organization really hungry for innovation and wanting to seed it within their own work. And I think that's a trend that I'm hoping will continue, because I think, you know, we have this saying, like, you know, change is inevitable, we just need to embrace it. And I think that particularly in Oakland, that is that's something that we're seeing throughout, whether it's human services, you know, our workforce development strategy or climate adaptation, like everyone's kind of thinking, how could I be doing my work a bit differently? So that's a really exciting trend. As far as, you know, technologies and partnerships, I think you are seeing the rise, obviously, of a lot of public-private partnerships and a lot of creative ones that aren't just about kind of the macro infrastructure projects, but how can we just scale community solar and community choice aggregation by partnering with some of these community solar nonprofits and for-profits. So I think it's a really exciting time to be, everything feels like it's on the table and is open for reinvention, and that feels really exciting to me.
I'm most excited about new models of economic development. It used to be the way you would develop your city, your town, or your region would be to invite a big company in to develop a campus and kind of take over the world from your location. And now we're seeing that really, if you start small and incrementally, that you can build this ecosystem, and it's very powerful. And so you see makers coming in and remaking the landscapes of places as disparate as Pittsburgh, Kansas City, North Carolina, Raleigh-Durham, North Carolina. And what these examples all have in common is that that they're true to the original founding stories, even, of the cities, that they're leveraging local goodness. So I'm very cheered by that as a trend. So new models of economic development. The second thing that I am focused on is a new generation of civic innovators coming in. I myself started my career post-Harvard at Massachusetts Department of Public Welfare. At the time, people thought I was crazy. I was, in fact, crazy, because my first job was to take 6 million welfare records that were stored, I am not kidding, in shoeboxes and automate them. That's how old I am. But what I've learned over time is that you really, you know, you crisscross, your career crisscrosses. And so what I want to do is be able to say 10 years from now that this is a valid career path to come in as a civic innovator, move into technology or move into the private sector and back, go back and forth.
Yeah, from my perspective, the biggest trend that we see in civic tech is the shift from the nonprofit model to the for-profit model. And as I mentioned earlier, there is definitely a trend of venture capital firms who 5 years ago would not have touched GovTech with a 10-foot pole because they believe in that the sales cycles are too long and it's too difficult a business model. Those firms are now investing in GovTech/civic tech companies. And we encourage that. You know, we have different motivations from traditional venture capital firms, but we want more capital to be going into this space to develop companies that can really scale and provide products that enhance the lives of millions of people. So we do see that as a trend. And when we started investing in this space, and when I say investing, I mean both grant making and for-profit investing, you know, 90% of what we saw were tech organizations that were organized as nonprofits.
While we still do see that today, the mix is definitely shifting to a much more balance between nonprofit and for-profit.
And do you draw a line between civic tech and GovTech?
So this is a great question. So, you know, there are as many definitions of civic tech as there are people in this room. But for us, you know, we define it pretty broadly and inclusively because we want lots of folks in the tent. For us, civic tech is any technology that is intended to either empower citizens and or enhance government service delivery. And so for us, GovTech is actually, you know, a subset of civic tech. It is the technologies that are used within government to improve government service delivery that may or may not have a direct citizen interface or resident interface, but are improving service delivery. And for us, GovTech, in addition to government-to-citizen connector tech and citizen-to-citizen tech, are the expanse called civic tech.
I feel that this marks the maturation of the sector that we're even having this conversation about definitions. Do we have time for audience questions? Do you want to take what? Fantastic. Does anybody in the audience want to offer a question? If not, I can keep firing away. I'll repeat the question just to make sure everyone heard the question, and I feel particularly qualified to do so because I was trained as a lawyer. What happens to all these good ideas once they hit the legal department? And I wonder if you're dealing with that, some of this now, Kieran, or will be soon.
So this is interesting. I'm a former city attorney myself before I went into startup land, into civic tech, and then came back to Oakland. I think that is definitely a very valid concern. One of my, I guess, ethos in the city attorney's office was always helping your client to get to yes, right? How can you make their innovative idea come to life given the structure and the regulations and whatnot that we live within? And truthfully, there are ways, you know, depending on what the matter might be, to think about things more creatively. For example, when I was in the city attorney's office, we had pioneered a partnership with Kiva, which is a peer-to-peer micro-lending platform that does not consider itself a civic tech platform, but in this way, we use them to crowdfund local entrepreneurs in Oakland between a partnership with the city and this nonprofit, and then the question became, how do we structure this partnership? And I think, really, when you talk about, you know, risk and limitation of liability and indemnity, I mean, these are the things that the city attorneys care about. And if you're able to say how you are taking those steps to minimize or how that shift might be happening with your private sector player or the nonprofit or whomever it might be, I think that puts you on more solid footing. Of course, there are host of other issues, whether it comes to open data and what are privacy considerations that you need to think about, that I feel like within city attorneys around the country and around the world, we need to start asking ourselves, are we getting those skill sets that are kind of thinking about 21st century governance? Are those skill sets coming into these offices? And I think that will help kind of see a lot of this innovation as well.
Well, and surely it helps to be able to point to other projects and other cities that are, and be able to say, well, Jay Nath did it in San Francisco, so...
What's interesting is that I think between San Francisco and Oakland, we have two of the most progressive cities in this country. And so we're usually the first movers on a lot of these issues. So it is interesting the way, I mean, I do think that we do have city attorneys who are creative for that reason, because our client is very creative.
And I would just add that the feedback we get from cities oftentimes is, it's absolutely great that Oakland and San Francisco are doing it, but it won't work here because. And so I think this the question about legal and how you get through the legal department is critically important. And so a lot of what we do at the foundation is try to take the innovative juice and spirit that exists here in the Bay Area and filter it in a way that it can be implemented locally. And whether that's saying, here's five policy hacks you can try, or here's bite-sized procurement that's been modeled by 18F, it's what we're really doing is looking to San Francisco and Oakland as leaders and to try to show people different methods that they could take, different routes along the road.
Five policy hacks you can try. Sounds like a really good BuzzFeed post. Well, and Stacy, you're seeing some non-governmental organizations get out in front on this, on innovations as well.
Yeah, so following on this question about legal and regulatory challenges, as I'm sure everyone in this room knows and has experienced, procurement is one of the biggest challenges to acquiring and implementing technology in government. And there's some really innovative things going on in the procurement space to help kind of make people think differently about how to manage that risk. I mean, obviously procurement systems were created with the best of intentions to ensure, you know, lack of corruption, et cetera, and to have some kind of standards around technology acquisition. Unfortunately, those regulations haven't really kept pace with the pace of technology, but there are, you know, both peer groups in government that are working on these issues, as well as third parties. There's a company that some of you may be familiar with called City Mart, that is based in New York now, but also operates internationally, that has done consulting around procurement and is also creating an actual technology platform to help acquirers of technology do problem-based procurement as opposed to just issuing RFPs for solutions, because it really starts at the very front end of trying to diagnose accurately the problem you're trying to solve before you go out and put out an RFP for a solution to that problem. So even in the parts of this that seem the least sexy and exciting, like procurement, there are some real innovations going on that give me hope for the sector writ large.
Oh, come on, everybody in this room thinks that procurement is exciting. There was another question over here. Well, and just to repeat again for the other side of the room, the question was, given what Stacy had said about allowing governments to shift the risk and be innovative, are there some best case scenarios, some examples, or some good practices that you've seen?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, we're seeing one of them right here, instantiated by Jay Nath, and having an innovation office within a local government is one way of doing that. I had mentioned New Urban Mechanics in Boston. I think that was one of the earliest examples of a mayor, Tom Menino, expressly creating an organization whose mission was to take all the risk that was not allowed to be taken elsewhere in the city government. And I think that was really a model for many of the others that came beyond. And Nigel Jacob and Chris Osgood are really responsible for creating that model of absorbing risk, being willing to take the chances that no one else would take for good reason because they weren't incentivized to do so. And that's become a model for many other cities.
Strong executive leadership seems like a prerequisite in many cases.
Well, and I would also argue that we're taking more risk by not asking ourselves those questions from the outset, right? Not doing the user research or thinking about who are we creating these services for. So in Oakland, you know, we're standing up a civic design lab similar to some of the efforts that Stacy mentioned to do just that, right? To bring folks in and these stakeholders who are informing these processes and to co-create solutions for success. So it's not just about passing a policy, checking it off, and saying we've done something. It's actually saying what this is an opportunity. How can we best serve our residents?
And I would add, I think, institutional support for innovation, but also, and this is going to sound weird, more case studies around failure. Because the cost in government is so high to fail that what we need is to really laud the people who tried and failed and kept their jobs.
Well, and one thing we used to joke about back in the early days was that on open data, it was always easier for someone to open the data when they were coming into a new term, because anything that got revealed by that open data was the other person's fault. So maybe as with the transfer of offices next year in some places, we'll have more opening of data there. Were there other questions from the audience?
Yes, so the question was, where are these new meeting points around for-profit civic tech? What does that evolution look like, if I understand your point correctly? So the places that we see it evolving most are either in GovTech, so those technologies that are used within government to help manage its services more directly, or in what I call citizen government connectors. So one of the early pioneers in the for-profit part of this space is a company called C-Click-Fix that's been around since 2011 or so, that is a platform, a mobile and web platform for residents to report non-emergency problems to their city governments. And they were one of the first to really experiment with a for-profit business model for something that is inherently, civic in its nature, someone who just wants to tell their city that there's a pothole or graffiti, et cetera. Now, what I've observed in the last, I'd say, year to 18 months are a lot of technology platforms focused on provision of social services that are organized as for-profits. And one of the early ones was Aunt Bertha, but now there are plenty. Propel is another one that's new out there. One of our portfolio companies is called Unite Us, that started as a platform to connect veterans to the wide variety of social services that they are eligible for and that are delivered locally and are extremely fragmented. And it's become kind of a case management platform that's now extending beyond the veteran community into to serve other communities who get social services. So. So the question was, who pays in these for-profit models? So in the case of C-Click-Fix, city governments pay. It's a SaaS model, software as a service, so it's a subscription that cities pay for. And in the case of the social services, it depends, but in the case of Unite Us, the veteran platform I mentioned, it's the service providers, whether they're governments or nonprofits, who also pay a subscription service. So it's not the consumer.
And so it seems like in a lot of cases, these companies are kind of coming into a model where there was already almost a procurement process in place, like a services provider for government that was providing those services in other ways, right?
Potentially, or governments were using their own homegrown solutions that weren't necessarily working well. And the kind of hack of the for-profit companies to date has mainly been that they price below procurement thresholds. And so that any kind of city decision maker can be charging the solution to their credit card and kind of working around that way. And that, while it's great for implementing something quickly, is not great for scaling companies who have a lot more services to offer for which they would like to, you know, be able to charge more money than today's procurement thresholds allow. So that's one of the challenges to the for-profit models in this space, is how do you get through today's procurement process if you have solutions that are worth spending a significant amount of money on.
Yeah.
there other questions from the audience? I know we're still waiting for our panelists for the next panel to be. But if not, we'll wrap up. Thank you all so much. This is a great panel. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, it's on. We're just going to give everybody 5 to 10 minutes to quickly eat some food, because I know everyone's freaking out that there's noise with cutlery, et cetera. So, and if they just sort of network at the table for 5 to 10 minutes, and then we're going to start the city leaders panel as Mayor Libby Schaff gets here too. Thank you. Objective. So I would like to actually kick off the city leaders panel. And I think a lot of you know Sid Espinoza, who actually is here at Microsoft, used to be the former mayor of Palo Alto, who will be moderating our session. Couldn't find a better person, so I'll just have him come up here. So Sid Espinoza. And of course, Mayor Ed Lee, the city of San Francisco, our host, and he opened up the summit last year. Love for Mayor Ed Lee to come out here too. Mayor Christine Sagen Helgo from Stavanger, Norway. She's come all the way from Northern Europe here, so I'd love to have her out here too. Her Excellency, Dr. Aisha Bin Bishr. She's the Director General of Smart Dubai Office. Thank you. And Mr. Chow Ho Chan, who's the Government Chief Information Officer for Singapore, who's all the way out here from Asia, too. We will have Mayor Libby Schaff crashing soon, so nobody be startled when she comes in and takes that last seat. Without further ado, I pass this over to Sid. Who has the mic? I think it might be over here. There you go, Sid.
Excellent. Well, thank you for the introduction. Thank you all for being here. I have to say it is always a little humbling to be in a room full of people who are really leading in a field that is growing and changing so quickly from across different sectors. The people in this room have been leading the work in civic tech, both here and around the world, and definitely want to applaud that. I remember it just wasn't too long ago, Stacey and I were just talking about sort of the early meetings about where civic tech was as we were hiring in our first chief innovation officer in the city, how quickly things were changing as startups and foundations and others started paying attention to the space, as different groups started convening conferences and conversations started to happen, and how quickly things have changed in that short period of time. In the last session, of course, a couple times, there were mentions of the importance of leadership from the top, right? And where you've seen the innovation now sort of at the federal level, starting to see it counties and states, but definitely in cities from the very beginning, you had mayors who got it, who understood that technology could be used in innovative ways to create smart cities and think about innovation in ways that could truly be transformative for the entire ecosystem of a city. And some of those folks are here today, and an honor to be able to hear from them. What we wanted to do was start with something broad, and then we're going to dive into some specific topics. Talk about, within this region, some of the interesting things that are happening and some of the partnerships and challenges, looking at some of the trends in Europe and some of the leadership that we're seeing there. Thinking about a place like Dubai and cities that can start from scratch, really, and think about how to grow from completely new. And then thinking about Asia as well and the leadership that we're seeing there really starting afresh. But let's start with sort of the broad sense of innovation, smart cities, and how you think about this space, why innovation is important in San Francisco, and what brought you to care about this work. Mayor Lee.
Well, thank you, Sid, and thank you to the other international panelists. This is fantastic to be here in SuperPublic and have visitors from around the world have a discussion with all of us about technology, about a modern city. Let me begin by saying just a couple weeks ago, we opened the gala statue of Tony Bennett at the Fairmont. And, you know, that's, of course, a tradition for San Francisco, and, of course, he's famous for his song. But a lot of us started thinking about what it is about our city. In the past, we've had traditions that drew people to this beautiful, wonderful city. But it can't always just be about what people remember about the city. It's also about what the city does for them today. And how do you make a city successful for everyone? And over the years, I've worked with so many departments, particularly our technology department and many of our innovative departments. And we're always struggling with the current demands and the future demands of our city. A growing population, a population that wants everything from its tradition to new sports teams, to the best transportations, to the answers to historical challenges that our cities face, from poverty, equity, language barriers, discrimination. All of those things continue to be challenges to the city like San Francisco. And what I'm very fortunate to be is that there are so many innovative companies out there that are figuring things out. And perhaps it's today a business objective or an IPO objective. And hopefully with our integration, it'll be helpful in solving transportation congestions. I know Mayor Schaff is suffering from that right now. And she'll be here shortly, and she'll have probably number one on her mind. How do we figure out congestion? How do we reduce crime? How do we help people out of poverty? How do we have less barriers to discrimination? Those are things that we want to solve, but we can't really solve them in our old traditional ways. We have to bring a lot more people together. We have to communicate even better ideas. And I think one of the themes here is we have to allow in the solving of these problems an ability to make some mistakes along the way that are acceptable mistakes, acceptable risks in order to get to the better answer. And I think that that's where cities are at today. And I'm lucky to be in San Francisco because we tolerate a lot of mistakes, but we also say we understand what direction we're all headed in. And this is where we'll get better transportation. I know Mark and I were talking already, Mark Dowd from Department of Transportation, about, hey, we didn't get this smart city challenge from the federal government, but we have all these people and all these entities and all these ideas that were amassed in the less than 2 weeks from major companies that were offering about $150 million of contributions to an idea that we can really be a smarter city if we all work together. Well, that idea has not died just because the funding wasn't there. It can be instigated. We are instigating that. And we want to have answers to how families can get around, how food maybe can be delivered, how kids and their parents can often meet their challenges without necessarily having to take one side out of work in order to meet the basic needs. So I think that these are just some of the general ideas about what we're still struggling with. It's still same old, maybe a lot of the problems that I describe are still very traditional problems for parents, for institutions, for government, or for private sector. But I think we now have the ability through technology and innovation to really come together on some of these things all together. And if all the parties do come together, as we're starting now in our startup residence program, you can literally identify some problems that we've never had an approach before. And I'll go into some detail later about some of those developments. But it does take the three big entities, business, government, and an acceptance by our communities and the nonprofits that serve them, all three kind of humming in a particular direction that allows for experimentation, ideas, but then also reconstructing a way to represent our values in the city and still be successful at it.
Thank you. It's great to be here in San Francisco. It's a beautiful city. This is my second time in San Francisco, and we really appreciate to come here and to learn from the best. I come from a town in Norway called Stavanger. It's in Europe, Scandinavia. And we've been the capital, the oil and energy capital of Norway. And We have a lot of technology, and we also have a lot of high competence people, and we have a lot of creative people also. So I think that technology, we can use technology, and the technology is there, I think. We can use technology to as a tool to improve and ease people's life. I think that's the main issue. And in Stavanger now, we have a lot of focus on costs in the energy sector. And the oil price is low. That's bad news for us. So we also have to create new jobs. So we do that by becoming a smart city. And I also think it's very cost efficient for a city. And also it will make, we will have more sustainable solutions for environment. That's also very important for us. So we're working really hard to become a smart city, and we're also part of Triangulum. That's an EU project. I can tell you about that later. And we also have the Norwegian Smart Care Cluster in Stavanger. So I think we have the possibilities to become a really smart city, but we have to come here to learn from other cities and to work really hard to improve on the smart city. Thank you.
First of all, I'd like to thank Your Excellency, the Mayor of San Francisco, and the organizer of the Bridge San Francisco 2016 to give me an opportunity to represent the city of Dubai and showcase the smart city transformation plans to the rest of the world. And when talking about innovation, it was always the objectives in Dubai and remains the same, the happiness of our people. We have been constantly dedicated making Dubai a happy city that is fueled by technology innovation, technology as a tool. So the real reason why we are doing this is we want to make life better for everyone. Yes, we do have the same challenges with other cities, but we need to be wise and implementing the best technologies to solve these challenges, and using the best tools that we have, especially that Dubai is a young city, so we don't have those old legacy solutions. And today, everything becomes smart, even smart water. And also by providing the right tools, not only tools, but also policies, to make sure that we govern this whole concept of smart cities. Today in Dubai, we are building a smart Dubai platform so that this will be the tool. And we've issued Dubai data law, so this is the policy. And also to complete the structure of a smart city, we've His Highness the ruler of Dubai, Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid, issued a decree of forming Smart Dubai Office to be the body to govern this transformation agenda. So it's about how to put all these three elements of an equation together to bring and to work as a facilitator and orchestrator to bring government, private, and individuals to solve the issue of the city. So it's not only the Smart Dubai Office, but collectively and collaboratively with everyone. And also unifying. So unlike any other smart city project, I've seen many smart cities projects, they were all focusing in a specific sector. But when you talk about a real smart city, it's about unifying everything around the city. The challenge of traffic will affect utility, will affect economy, and so forth. So you need to bring everyone in the same picture, put a proper platform that unify all the projects and solutions in the city to have one window for everyone so that they can see the same challenge collectively. So this is basically what we are doing in Dubai. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Chow Ho. I'm from Singapore, and there's a good and bad thing about Singapore is that it's really small, and it's both a city and a country. So the challenges are, I'm not the mayor of Singapore because the mayor is my prime minister, right? So it's kind of a different set of problems altogether. But I think one thing we realized quite far back is the fact that there's a limit to how much physical infrastructure you can build in a city. And therein lies the challenge, because the city is growing so fast that building more roads, more public transportation, etc., is just not feasible. It's just going to cost more and more. And so innovation is important. It's not about building more physical infrastructure, but it's about trying to use technology to optimize the infrastructure that we have. And one thing we realize is that most infrastructure are built for peaks in peak hours, but most of the other times it's really not leveraged. It's probably like 30% utilization. Question is that how do you use technology to spread those kind of loads to really optimize the scarce infrastructure that every city is going to face going forward? The second thing we realized is quite interesting is that for a long time, government never thought of. Government operate in silos because it's always very much a supply-driven kind of economy, whereby we think that we know what everybody wants, and the reality is that we don't. So I came from the private sector. I was hired about two and a half years ago. I spent most of my life in the financial sector, actually. And when I first came in, I was talking a lot about customers. And one day, a guy kind of plucked out enough courage to tell me, say, you know something? There are no customers here. You're now in the private sector. So I look at this guy and say, are you sure? And that kind of underlined a very interesting mindset. The government never thinks of citizens as customers. It's something, it's someone out there, amorphous millions that we do something for. But when you start looking at citizens as customers, then all of a sudden the problems that we are faced with becomes a lot more either easier or more difficult to solve, because it's not about what department you're from. It's about the fact that there is a problem out there, and it probably takes about five departments to solve the problem. So the mindset change is important, and that leads to a lot more innovative solution than before. So, I mean, there's a lot more to talk about, but I think I'll just stop at that.
Mayor Schaff, welcome. We're starting with just a general question about innovation and why it's important to you and what innovation challenges you're facing in the city of Oakland.
Thank you, and thank you for excusing my tardiness. I did take public transportation to get here. I think that's smart and innovative of me. So in the city of Oakland, I love that already I can hear the conversation that a smart city is not just about like looking at the bright, shiny thing and being attracted to the latest, greatest technology. It's smartness is about technology in the service of what? For a long time, we've talked about technology as creating a digital divide, actually exacerbating inequality and inequity in our societies. But smart can be about using technology to drive the end of that, the digital bridge rather than divide. Smart is also recognizing that technology is only as useful as the people who are utilizing it. And I have shamelessly stolen a phrase that my chief resiliency officer, Kieran Jan, created, which is, free the entrepreneurial bureaucrat. That government is full of people who truly care about serving communities, and that we need to give them the permission and the tools to look up off of their desks and be user-focused. You called it customer, we call it user-focused, but to look up from the task at hand and say, what is the end goal? Who are we trying to serve? And that is, I think, what is smart. I mean, here we are in the center of innovation, and that has been inspiring, because I think being surrounded by the kind of startup culture reminds us that government needs a little bit more permission to fail. That too long we have kind of been safe by just doing the task assigned as opposed to trying something that might fail, but will help us learn and actually sometimes discover something truly great. Now, I don't know if you want us to talk about specific examples of collaborations or innovations.
I think we're going to dive into that now.
All right.
All right.
I'll put down my microphone.
No, that's good. I think that we, you know, there frankly are a whole host of conversations that could happen over hours with any one of you about what's happening in your regions. And we're at a point in the evolution of civic tech and in thinking about smart cities to really start to understand models that are working, right, differences. And I feel like we're going to get shortchanged just because we are limited on time. So we're going to start by just diving deep, right where you were, Mayor Schaff, about the work in this region. One of the models that people are trying to figure out is how you work across cities. And it's a big topic of conversation as we talk about the needs within this region, because the issues that have already been raised, transportation, affordable housing, other things, can't be solved by one city. And what happens in San Francisco affects the East Bay, it affects the Peninsula, it affects the North Bay, et cetera. So when we're talking about innovation and we're talking about how we think about solving problems both within our own municipality and in the broader region, I was hoping that both you and Mayor Lee could talk about how you think about innovation when you have control and when you don't have control, and how you think about that work on a regional basis. Mayor Lee, we can start with you.
Well, I can speak in specifics. I mean, I know this Friday we're together again for the last 2 weeks.
It'll be like the fourth time in 10 days, seriously.
So regionalism is already being established. But we're together on a big announcement that our cities, for the first time, really are doing, and that is bike share. Today, in the Bay Area region, we have maybe 700 bike share sites, and we now have sponsors that want our region to grow from 700 to 7,000 in the next 10 years. And it's Oakland and San Francisco and all the cities and counties in between and around the peninsula that will join us, Santa Clara, San Jose included, to get the 7,000, and we're excited about it because it allows us to think about modes of transportation that we should be thinking that is a positive thing for our cities. It's been growing on its own, but how do we create the infrastructure to make sure that is as successful as it can be? This is what we're already working on, and these are things that we'll have to do. We will have to sit down and talk together about where the points of use are, how did they pick up and take off, how are they connected to the other modes of transportation so that you can leave that rented bike any place you wish and still have another mode of transportation that will accommodate your needs. Those are all the things we're working on, and if you think about it, if we don't do this regionally, you can have that within the city, but people don't just travel within the city. A great percentage of San Francisco's workforce lives in Oakland.
More and more every day.
And a great deal of people who live in Oakland work in San Francisco. And we have to understand that and accept the fact. That's a fact. It's no longer us versus Oakland. It's about us working together for the benefit of people that live and work in the entire Bay Area. Once you recognize that, then the bicycle thing is just a start. There's so many other things working on, and we mentioned earlier we were together. We're already working on education. The experiment that we had with Salesforce Foundation and their contribution to entire middle grades and computer science now be having acceptance throughout our whole school system has gotten to the ears of the school district in Oakland. And of course, they expressed dire needs to lift up their education. And we got to make all the mistakes the last 3 years so we can share with Oakland all the unmistakes that they get to have. And we're really glad to do it because, again, we're about now, I think our recognition is we don't just go residents for Oakland and San Francisco. We grow Bay Area talent. And if we recognize that Bay Area talent is going to allow our entire area to compete with the likes of Paris, Shanghai, London, that's where the real competition is.
So Mayor Lee and I did two press conferences together just last week. one about the Salesforce support of the schools, and one we're both doing soda taxes around health. And these are issues: health, education, workforce development, affordable housing, transportation, even crime. These issues do not respect municipal boundaries. And so Sam and Ed and I, so Sam Accardo's the mayor of San Jose, we talk frequently, particularly around the issue of transportation, which we have to talk together about, and more about the issue of jobs-housing balance, because that, again, is a regional issue. It does not respect boundaries. And that not only has led to a lot more collaboration on regional bodies, and I think we've been part of a push to, and I'm jealous of other parts of the country that have stronger regional authorities. Our regional authority is not very strong. We've had a separate authority for housing planning versus transportation planning. That doesn't make sense. And so we've been part of the push to consolidate those two regional planning departments, ABAG and MTC, to be a unified planning, regional planning authority. And I think that we also are going to push for it having some more power. And that's a scary thing. Mayors giving up power and ceding it to a regional authority is not going to be popular. But I think that when we look at the problems this region is having right now, it really points to a failure or maybe a inability to, of foresight, maybe that's a fair term, for our regional planning.
Mayor Christine, let me ask you about the work in the EU, because there, of course, there is an information sharing and a trying to understand best practices, I think even more than you see here in the US. We're talking about two cities here that are sort of forced to work together. There are a bunch of consortiums now within Europe that are getting cities in different countries every city has a smart city initiative, right? We were talking about the fact that City of Barcelona, often heralded as one of the great examples of a smart city, now has a new mayor, not on the agenda anymore, not a priority. Will that work continue? So thinking about how you institutionalize policies and programs so that they're sustained over time and really understand best practices is, I think, an area where we can learn a lot from the EU. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the cities that you're partnered with, what that looks like, and how that model works for you.
Yes. First of all, I have to say that in Norway and in Europe in general, it's still very common to work on different and independent smart city projects. And I think that's we have to change that. And EU, they have, it's the world's biggest innovation program called Horizon 2020, and they have a smart city Horizon 2020 project called Trianglum Lighthouse, and it's Stavanger in Norway, and it's Eindhoven in the Netherlands, and it's Manchester in the UK, and we have smart city projects within ICT, mobility, and energy. And we have to share best practice, and we also have to share all the knowledge of our projects, and we also have following cities. So we have to learn from each other, and I think we have to set these things in a system, because otherwise all the cities are going to or have to do it themselves. And that will not be sustainable for the future. And I think that also in Norway, because this is an EU project, I think the government also have to make some initiatives so that cities in Norway will be more smarter. I think that's, I've told them many times, and I hope they'll listen now. but I think it's very important for the future, because otherwise it's going to be very hard to make the right solutions for the inhabitants. And I think also I agree on that you have to communicate with the inhabitants, and what you, the technology also is got to be adaptable, something that people really want. Otherwise, it's no good. One example from my city was that we made some alarms for elderly people. So if they fell on the floor and couldn't come up, they could, you know, put the button, and then it was an alarm going in at the nursery home, an office. But you know, people, they don't want to go with a button around their neck, so they didn't use it, because all the other inhabitants would see that, okay, you need help. So I think we have to really, it's important what kind of technology we want to make into smart solutions. So that was a little bit from Stavanger.
Let's shift regions and talk a little bit about Dubai. It is, for those who haven't been, of course, an incredible combination of centuries of history and culture, and now change and innovation happening very quickly. I know as mayor, one of the things I always wish I had was a magic wand where I could just say, we're now going to do this. But a lot in Dubai and in Abu Dhabi and other places, they're able to, we're now going to build a city here, and they're able to do it. But when it comes though to civic tech and to change at a smart city level, you can't help but look to Dubai, because they have made decisions and proclamations that they will be bold, that they will do this in the right way and really lead the world. And so hopefully you could share some of that with us and how it works in the dichotomy of the region and the culture.
Sure. Life is not easy, as you mentioned. Huh? I wish we have the magic coin. But the thing that we have a very demand leader in my country, whether it be in the federal level or in the local level. Also, we are blessed that the ruler of the city that I'm from is the same as the Prime Minister, Hassan Sheikh Hamad bin Rashid. He's a very visionary person, and when he decides something, we had to do it. And again, we are blessed that his passion is to make his people happier. That's why Smart Dubai for us was one of the first initiatives that adopted His Highness' vision for people's happiness. And one statement he said is, the role of government is to make people happy. That's why we are trying to adopt such vision in every initiative and project we are doing back home. So happiness is the core strategic objectives of a smart city. It's a very unique approach, because until now I didn't see any other smart city has such bold vision as their objectives or a goal for the smart city. All what we do in Dubai is to try to put a lot of performance measurement to measure how happy our people, but also taking it from a scientific base. How can we increase their happiness through the experience they take it in the city? So happiness, experience, and then efficiency, how efficient this experience and how impactful this experience and how seamless is this experience. And just a few months ago, His Highness launched or announced the happiness agenda in Dubai that will fuel the happiness as part of the city transformation, wherein we take the technology as an enabler for such transformation. And we are adopting a very global, unique, science-based and methodical approach into impacting happiness for the whole city. So we study the needs of our people and then try to impose lots of policies to improve or fulfill these needs, and try to educate them also about what's been done to fulfill these needs, and do again the measurement. So it's a very basic and simple cycle. But nevertheless, we still have lots of projects and challenges, such as
mobility or traffic, utility, housing. When it comes to housing, government covering a lot of housing prospects, especially for native people or locals. But even when it comes to residents, with the booming of real estate, even though globally it seems that things are going down, back in Dubai, everything is booming, alhamdulillah. Many towers and many districts are being developed, especially with the Expo 2020 is coming in 4 years. So a lot of constructions happen in Dubai. So when it comes to housing, we have good programs for it. But when it comes to transportation, we have very extreme weather, which is very hot. Today back in Dubai, it's 115. Still summer. Even though that the government introduced the shared bicycle, but who will use bicycle in this weather? So it tend to be that these bicycles being used by tourists during winter time. Again, our culture is different than here. People tend to use their own car. They don't like to pool or share cars. So we implemented a lot of these programs, but this has not been adapted because the culture is different back home. So again, we are trying to be a lot innovative around what type of solution we need to bring back home. Because in the last 5 years, we've been like benchmark and bring whatever best practice across the globe and implement it back in Dubai. But we need to be efficient also with all this investment we are doing. When it comes to utility, again, the government and the leaders put a direction to utilize solar energy. Yes, our country have lots of sun, but the thing that with the dust, we cannot produce solar energy. So now we need to be innovative around how to improve the technology around solar energy so that we can extract the energy. Thank God lately this technology being produced, so now we are really pushing when it comes to solar energy. So by 50% of our energy will come from a solar or renewable energy. Smart meters being implemented across the city. Also, when it comes to electrical vehicles, it was like the egg and chicken case, which one to go, whether to bring the cars or to build the infrastructure. So the government went ahead and built 100 electrical vehicle stations across the city. And now it's people, if they will adapt and bring such kind of cars to the city. So we are trying different solutions and projects across all the dimensions of the city, whether it be from an infrastructure as building the platform for the city and opening the data, sharing the data across the government, and also opening to the public, make sure that we develop a proper platform, not only for Dubai, but also for the region to attract talents. But also keeping the citizens as the center of our agenda, wherein their happiness is what we seek with all the projects that we are doing.
Thank you. First, apologies, first to everybody in the room and to our panelists, because we are out of time. I felt like I could interrupt at a million different points with 10 more questions and go deep and really understand some of these issues, but we have a finite amount of time, and I want to thank, if I could get everybody to join us in a round of applause for all of our panelists today. Thank you so much. Sorry to cut the conversation short. I want to give folks a chance to wrap up. Someone's coming up.
Yes.
Yep. All right. Thought we were. So thanks to the panel here and also to our previous panel. I think I speak for everybody saying if we ended the week today, this would be a fantastic week already. I want to introduce our closing speaker, a fellow Fed. Mark Dowd is the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Research and Technology for the United States Department of Transportation. And he'll be closing us out. Mark, thank you.
I will make this brief. It's hard to the mayors and the cities around our country and obviously around the world are all struggling with a similar problem. From my perspective, we're at a moment. The Smart City Challenge kind of, from my perspective, woke up not just a city like yours or the Bay Area, where you have incredible capacity and learning and smart people trying to solve problems, but across the country, from Anchorage to Albuquerque, you have cities that don't normally think this way. They don't normally think of technology and innovation as a way to solve the 21st century problems that are coming. We focus on medium-sized cities, and San Francisco is definitely a medium-sized city. And why? Why medium-sized cities? 1 in 5 people live in medium-sized cities. Medium-sized cities are growing 3 times as fast as the rest of the country. 70 million people that our country will grow, 3/4 of those people will end up in medium-sized cities. 1 billion metric tons of carbon are emitted every year by medium-sized cities. And to echo the gentleman from Singapore, you can't build your way out of it. So if you can't build your way out of the problems, what are your other solutions? And to the issue that Dubai identified, which is there are solutions that work in some places and don't work in other places. And how do we as a country or as in the world and trying to figure out our solutions, how do we figure them out faster? We can't wait 2-3 years to pilot something for a city to look at the data and then look up and then share. We can't do it that way. We have to collaborate together. And the 7 cities that were the finalists in the Smart City Challenge, San Francisco being one of them, were able to take the $40 million that we offered and raise $500 million. $500 million of private sector foundation money. Why? Because we're in that moment. I think people realize we're at a place where technology can be used in a city environment to try to solve problems, but not for technology purposes. The mayor of Oakland correctly stated that we need to understand what the problem is or any technology will do. So from our perspective, and what we're going to try to do is have the 7 cities that were the finalists work in a collaborative manner to try to put together, they've already identified the problems in their cities, to work collaboratively, try to figure out what those solutions are, and then create hopefully a market for technology companies, foundations, universities, NGOs, and the federal government to come in and help them solve those problems. So that's what I wanted to close with, is the idea of collaborating together is easy to say. It's not intuitive to cities. Mayors are not elected to solve another mayor's problem. But if you can figure out a way to bring funding and capacity to the cities, you can provide that incentive and the basis to collaborate together. Thank you.
On behalf of SUPERPUBLIC and the General Services Administration, I just want to thank everyone for participating today and listening. We do have to end the program. If we go after 6, everyone has to sleep here because it's a federal building. I'm just kidding. It's a bad scene. I'm really looking forward to this week, and I hope all of you are as well. The program looks fantastic, and thanks again. Thank you.